last few lectures, before last week, we kind of taken turn into more of the type of physics that I do, talking about risk assessment and why we're building the LHC and the fact that it won't destroy the world and that kind of thing. And so last week I figured we should be a little more grounded in terms of the topic of the series, which is what is part of what it's done for you. So talk about computer methods and developing the internet and that sort of thing. But today we're gonna go back into my territory, although with a little more emphasis on the focus of the series, which is how do accelerators work, how do detectors work. So today we're gonna be talking about detectors because we want to talk about what has the Large Hadron Collider found so far. So this year, we've only been running since the beginning of this year. On March 30th, we started up with colliding protons with other protons at the highest energy that's ever been achieved in the lab, 7 trillion electron volts, 3.5 in each beam, and because it's head-on, you can just add them together, so 7 trillion. We ran continuously as much as possible. And this meant achieving collision rates of protons up to 14 million per second. And that's only a small fraction of our overall goal of what we're eventually going to try to get to. Eventually, once this thing is running at what we designed it for, it's going to be able to do up to 1 billion collisions per second. So we still have a ways to go. But it's ran pretty well over the last 7 months. We ran colliding protons up until November 4th, about 2 weeks ago. During that time, what I put here is this is a chart showing how much data we've accumulated over time. And it starts back here. This is March. The end of March. This is the beginning of November. And although it might look like we haven't done anything here in the middle, we actually were accumulating data, but the rate was so slow that it doesn't even show up on this chart. You can start seeing it around June is where you start just barely seeing a black line. And then what happens is you just see this exponential rise in the amount of data we've recorded. So the last data we took of proton collisions was right at the beginning of this month. And you can see from this slope here, we're just, it's just getting faster and faster. And so we hope that trend is going to continue next year, just to continue getting this exponential rise in data taking. What's going on here is that the accelerator operators are putting more protons in the machine at one time and colliding. You have more in the machine, you have more that you can collide every second. So that's why we got this really nice exponential rise in the amount of data we've taken. So we ran for 7 months. Today we're going to talk about what have we learned over the last 7 months. What has this machine taught us in the last 7 months? And I should just mention that this is really just the beginning of our research program. The Large Hadron Collider is intended to run for 10, 20, maybe 30 years. So we've really got a long research program ahead of us, and this is really just the first taste of what we can do with this. So to talk about what we've seen, we first have to talk about how we've seen it. And to do that, we have 2 general purpose detectors at the Large Hadron Collider. We have the compact muon solenoid, or CMS. That's one general purpose detector. The other one is the detector I work on called ATLAS, which is kind of a mangled acronym, but it stands for a toroidal LHC apparatus. The S on the end gives you ATLAS. But anyway, both of the detectors are built in layers around the collision point of the protons. What you're looking at here is kind of a generalized detector, a general purpose detector. Looking at it head on, it actually looks like a cylinder from the side. So you can just imagine it as something like a soup can or something. And this is what it looks like head on. And what we do is we wrap around the collision point, we wrap different types of detectors. That's what these different colors are. And I'll go into detail about what they're actually made of and how they work. Now the reason we do this is each detector has some type of particle, some class of particles that it's sensitive to. So what these, you know, black lines and dotted lines are supposed to represent is what are these detectors sensitive to. So for example, in the middle here, we have what's called a tracking detector. I'll talk about that in a few minutes. For now, I'll just say that it's sensitive to anything with an electric charge. So something like a muon, an electron, a charged hadron. What's a charged hadron? Hadron is anything that experiences the strong nuclear force. So a charged hadron would be something like a proton. There are other subatomic particles that fall into that class as well, but one we're familiar with is a proton. So those are things that leave signals in our tracker. But things without an electric charge, like photons or neutral hadrons, like a neutron, that's not going to leave a signal there. So we build different types of detectors to get at things with neutral charges. So yellow here is what we call an electromagnetic calorimeter, and that's sensitive to things like photons and electrons, and kind of sensitive to charged hadrons and muons, but not very much. So we wrap yet another layer around it. It gives you the hadrons now, and then finally the last thin layer tells you whether or not you have a muon, because that's the only thing that's going to survive out to that point without being absorbed. So I'm talking about detecting different types of particles, of course these are only a small fraction of the particles that are produced at the Large Hadron Collider. Most of the ones that are produced decay very rapidly. So the only thing that we actually see here are particles that live long enough to travel a few meters, 3, 5, 10 meters, maybe not 10, but so something on the order of a few meters. So what that gives you, that tells you about the lifetime of these particles. They're traveling at just about the speed of light. So that means they have to live for at least 10 nanoseconds or so, 10 billionths of a second. Anything that lives shorter than that is just going to decay right here in the center, and we're only going to see its decay products. And that's what we're actually detecting with all of these different layers. We're detecting decay products of the really interesting stuff that's going on at the center here. So the things we're detecting are in the first two generations of matter. You might remember this chart from a few weeks ago, 2 weeks ago. The first generation of matter here encompasses things that we're all familiar with from chemistry. Up and down quarks go into protons and neutrons. So that's what's in an atomic nucleus. And also the electron here, that's what orbits the atomic nucleus. And we're not going to worry about the neutrinos for now because we can't see them in our detector. So we see everything in the first generation except neutrinos. And then we also see a couple of things from the second generation of matter. We see muons, see these guys here, and we see things containing strange quarks, because those tend to live longer than 10 nanoseconds. They live not much longer, but long enough to at least get some of the way through our detector. So for the next few minutes, I'm going to talk about how each of these detection layers actually work. And there are two words I want you to remember about this, because this is what everything is based on. Ionization and scintillation. That's it. These are the two types of physical processes that we use to detect particles, ionization and scintillation. We've talked a little bit about scintillation before. If you remember way back to the second lecture when we talked about PET scans and MRIs. I talked about how scintillation works. So later on I'll remind you about it, but I'm not going to go into detail. What I will talk a bit more about is ionization. So what do I mean by ionization here? I mean when a particle with an electric charge, it doesn't happen for neutral particles, just electrically charged particles, when it passes through matter, any type of matter, it tends to pick off electrons. It tends to eject electrons from atoms. So that's what I'm showing up here. You've got some energetic particle coming in, and it takes an electron completely out of an atom. So it ionizes it. It gives that atom a positive charge. So that's what I'm representing with these positive charges here along the path of the particle. And then you just have electrons, these negatively charged guys, just getting kicked off. That's basically it. That's what ionization is. And with each electron that's ejected here, this initial charged particle that's coming through here loses a little bit of energy. That energy is going into kicking this electron off in some direction. So this process here has actually been used to detect particles pretty much since the beginning of particle physics. So back in the day, you had these bubble chamber experiments, which gave you these beautiful pictures of charged particles going through, in this case, a gas. And as they left their trail of ions, those became what are called nucleation sites, or places where you get bubbles emerging out of this gas, and you could, you know, take basically a photograph of it and get pictures like this. So we don't use this kind of technology anymore. What we do these days is to get these same types of pictures is we use things like semiconductors, so silicon is a very popular technology for this, or gas-filled chambers with wires going across them. So what these semiconductors are doing, or what these wire chambers are doing, is taking that ionization signal, these electrons getting kicked off, and converting that into, they're collecting that charge and turning it into an electrical signal that we can read out with our electronics and feed that through a computer or something, and turn that into usable information. So that brings us to this first thing here, this blue area. How do we do charged particle tracking? What you get is, with a wire chamber like I just mentioned, or like silicon, is you get these individual squares here. These squares are what we call hits. In the previous slide on this thing, they're like, I guess you can't see it here, but these trails are actually small circles that are coming from bubbles, and so you get a trail of small circles, and that creates a path through the detector. What we get are these individual square hits, and what you're seeing with these multicolored lines are the reconstructed paths that we determine through computer software, basically. So what's the use of this? What information do we get out of this when we track the trajectory of charged particles? We get two pieces of information. We get one, their electric charge, which is based on which direction they're curving in. And why are they curving? Because we put this entire thing inside a big magnetic field. And anytime you have a charged particle, an electrically charged particle moving through a magnetic field, it's going to curve. And so the direction of the curvature gives us the electrical charge, whether it's positive or negative. And the other piece of information we get is momentum. It's related to how much energy the particle has and how massive it is. And the momentum is given by the amount of curvature. So the things that are curving a lot, let's say this red track here on the side, something that's curving a lot has a very low momentum. It's being really influenced by that magnetic field around it. Something that doesn't curve so much, like this green track right next to it, has a higher momentum, so it's going to be a bit straighter. So we get these individual hits, reconstruct the paths that these particles are taking, and with the curvature provided by the magnetic field, we can get their electric charge and roughly how fast they're going, or how much momentum they have. So with our what we call tracker in my experiment Atlas, it's about 2.5 meters from side to side, and we have a 2 Tesla magnetic field in there. So that's something comparable to what you would have. It's even bigger than an MRI machine, but the magnetic field is about the same as you would have in an MRI. The other experiment, CMS, they have a much bigger magnet. Their magnet is about 6 meters in diameter. It's almost 20 feet. And they have a much stronger magnetic field, 4 Tesla, which somebody remarked to me is that's what you need to give an elephant an MRI. You can fit an elephant inside CMS's magnet and give it an MRI for some reason. But that's not what we use it for. The other thing I should mention here is the resolution of these individual hits, the precision with which we can say where they are is very fine. We can get resolutions down to about 10 microns, that's 10 millionths of a meter. So that gives us very precise knowledge of where these particles went, how much momentum they had, and what their charge is. So that's what we use for tracking here. And just to give you an idea of what these things actually look like, these are the different types of detectors that are used in the Atlas experiment for tracking. So very close to the beam, we have this. This is actually kind of a small setup here, but you see these individual chips. These are actually silicon arranged in pixels. It's actually very similar to what you have inside your digital camera. You just have an array of pixels. And it's probably made out of silicon or some other semiconductor. So that's what we use in the innermost part. As you go farther out, we use, instead of pixels of silicon, we use long strips of it. It's cheaper. We have more of it, so you know, you have to balance effectiveness versus cost. And then the farthest out, we have our wire chamber. This thing is filled with a gas. The gas gets ionized by particles passing through, and then we use wires strung across it to pick up those signals. CMS, the other experiment, actually just chose to go with all silicon. They don't have any wire chambers. So you can see the technology looks very similar to what we use on my experiment. Again, they have silicon arranged in pixels, and they also have a silicon strip detector. You can see here, this is kind of the cylindrical geometry I was talking about earlier, where you have everything arranged in concentric circles around the interaction point and extending for some length along this direction. So that's how we track the innermost part of the detector. That's how we get information on charged particles. The next thing we're going to talk about here is this yellow part. How do we get information about things that don't leave tracks in our detector? Things like photons, or things that do leave tracks in our detector, but you know, we want to distinguish them, distinguish between electrons or charged hadrons or muons. And to do that, we use what's called an electromagnetic calorimeter. Now, what electromagnetic refers to is that it's based on the electromagnetic force. So it's really good at detecting electrons and photons. It's not as good at detecting things that experience a strong force like charged hadrons or things that don't really interact too well like muons or things that don't have electric charge like neutrons. But it is good at detecting electrons and photons, and we get a lot of those, so we want to know where they are and how much energy they have. So that's the other part of the name. Calorimeter refers to measuring how much energy these things have. So there's a couple of different technologies that are used for this. On the CMS experiment, not the one I work on, they use crystals. And this is, you might remember if you were here for the second lecture, when I talked about PET scans, they used a type of crystal for detecting their signals. This is essentially the same technology that CMS uses to detect electrons and photons. The crystal here is made out of lead tungstate, so it's basically a type of salt, but it's heavy. And what they do is they get a little flash of light in here as an electron or a photon passes through, and the amount of light is proportional to how much energy that thing had, and they read it out with this little bit of electronics on the end here. So what they've done is they've taken about 70,000 of these crystals and arranged them in a big cylindrical array around the interaction point. On my experiment, Atlas, we use a completely different technology. This technology here is based on scintillation. It's based on making a little flash of light. But on Atlas, we actually use, again, we use ionization technology. What we're ionizing here is liquid argon. Argon is an inert gas, in order to liquefy it, we have to cool it down to about just 80 degrees above absolute zero. So it's almost, you know, minus 200 Celsius or so. It's really cold. And what we do is, you see this kind of accordion-shaped bit of metal here. You see it from two different views. This is kind of the framework for our detector, and we fill in this whole thing with liquid argon. So as charged particles are passing through and ionizing the argon, we can pick up those signals on this metal running throughout the detector. So it's a different technology. I don't know that one is fundamentally better than the other. It's just different choices that the collaborations made. Both of these technologies are used to detect signals from electrons and photons. So moving out to the next layer is our hadronic calorimeter. So again, it's a calorimeter. It's something that measures energy. But in this case, it wants to measure the energy of hadrons, because those are the hadrons are, again, particles that experience a strong force. So things like protons, charged hadrons, or neutrons, neutral hadrons, and other types of subatomic particles that we haven't talked about, those get picked up in this hadronic calorimeter. And both of the main experiments, ATLAS and CMS, have done their hadronic calorimeters in about the same way. What you do is, you can kind of see it in real life here. This is the CMS hadronic calorimeter. You can see it's mainly made out of brass. That's why they've got this, that's what gives it the color here. And you can see these little lines going across it. And so what it is that it's actually layers of brass that we call absorber, because it's absorbing hadrons through nuclear interactions. And we interleave that with scintillator, basically plastic tiles that light up when something goes through them. So I'll show you a little more of a schematic picture of what's going on here. You have your absorber that's brass in the case of CMS, or steel in the case of my experiment, ATLAS. And as a proton or a neutron goes in, it has a nuclear interaction. And the way we detect that is when it has this interaction, it spits out some other particles. Those go through the scintillator, leave a little bit of light. And since these tend to be, again, strongly interacting particles, they might have another nuclear interaction, and another. And so that's why we have all of these layers here, because we want to break down the energy of the thing going in. And we break it down through nuclear interactions because this thing is held together by a strong nuclear force. And the scintillator gives us roughly how much energy, if we add everything up, how much energy was in this original one. It's not exactly true. We can't get all of the energy, because sometimes in these nuclear interactions, a proton or a neutron just gets absorbed and it doesn't come out. It makes a new atomic nucleus. And so you do actually lose some energy. You're not reconstructing everything. So that's why it's important for us to work on calibrating these things to make sure we can get it right. But again, the point here is that we want to detect things that interact through the strong force, and both ATLAS and CMS have constructed their detectors in the same way for this type of system. So the last thing I want to talk about is just this thin gray layer on the outside. We call that our muon detector, because the only thing that's going to make it out to that point is the muon, the heavy cousin of the electron. Why does it make it out that far? Because it'll go through your tracking chamber here. Nothing gets absorbed here. Then it passes through the electromagnetic calorimeter, where electrons get absorbed. But muons, which are similar to the electron but much heavier, have enough inertia. They have enough momentum, usually, to just go straight on through, maybe leaving a little bit of a signal, but not much. And same with the hadronic calorimeter, even though it's much thicker, it's got a lot more material. Again, the muons just shoot straight on through. So what this Abbert detector does is it just detects basically the presence of a charged particle, again through ionization. The only things that can make it out that far are muons. Everything else is going to get absorbed. So what does this look like? This is what we call a schematic for what we call a muon chamber. It's basically two metal plates, top one and the bottom one. It's filled with some kind of gas, and as the muon goes through, it's going to again ionize the gas. That's ionization and scintillation. That's how we do all of our work. Now what's happening here is the muon doesn't leave a whole lot of energy when it ionizes something. So we have to amplify this signal. That's why I've connected these plates and shown it's got about 2,000 volts across it. The muon detectors for both experiments work very similar to this. They've got a very high voltage and a very thin gas-filled chamber. And what's going to happen here is this muon goes through and ionizes the gas. It's going to spit out electrons. It's going to stick them off of these atoms. And then because of this voltage here, these electrons are going to rush towards the positive plate, which in my case I've labeled the top one as positive. And on the way, those electrons are going to pick up energy, and they're going to ionize other atoms that are in their way. That's going to kick off more electrons, and so you get this shower of electrons. It gives you a pretty large signal by the time it gets to your plate. So, So we see those signals, and we say, all right, something went through there, and because the only thing that can make it out that far is a muon, we say, all right, that's probably a muon. So this is just an example of how we arrange these different plates. This is from my experiment, Atlas. You can see we have this kind of array of long paddle-shaped plates. This is what an individual module looks like. And then here's a different type of construction, but it's the same idea. You can get these long, flat plates, I mean, really as long as these tables, but just very thin. And those, again, can just be used for detecting this ionization as a muon goes through your detector. So the last thing I want to talk about with the experiments, the one big thing that distinguishes the two experiments is how their magnetic fields are set up. I already mentioned the magnetic field a little bit, which gives us information on the charge and the momentum of particles passing through. So what we're going to talk about first is CMS, the compact muon solenoid. The reason they call it that is because they use a solenoidal magnetic field. All right, what is that? It's a magnetic field, and actually these field lines here look very similar to a bar magnet. If you just have regular magnet, like a north end and a south end, this magnetic field is going to look similar to this. Where solenoid comes in is solenoid describes this style of winding electrical wire in a coil. You run some current through that, just electrical current, and it creates a magnetic field like this. So you have, let's say this is your north end, this is your south end. So the magnetic field is pointed in this direction going to the right when it's inside the coil, and then it wraps around and goes the other direction outside the coil. And so with CMS, this is the experiment now, you have your magnetic field going one way inside of it, and then wrapping around and going the other way through this red part, through the muon system. And so what that gives you, when you're tracking particles through that detector, is this is now a slice of their detector. You can see taking a slice out of it here. You have particles, bending one way or another inside their what they call their inner tracker. That's where the magnetic field is pointed in one direction along the detector. And if we follow, say, a muon through it, see the muon goes through the tracker, through the calorimeter, through the other calorimeter, through both calorimeters here, and it makes it out to the muon system. And now it actually changes its direction because the magnetic field is going the other direction here. It's wrapped around it. It's coming back basically. So you get these nice kind of S-shaped tracks going through the system. That's kind of it's what they use for their logo. So that's how CMS built their tracker, their detector. It's based around having this magnetic field go in two different directions. On Atlas, this is my experiment now, we do something a little bit different. We do have a solenoidal magnetic field in the middle here, but this part where the magnetic field turns around and goes back is it happens inside our hadronic calorimeter. So we don't get much of a signal from muons as that's happening. Where we actually get our signal from muons is farther out in our detector, and we actually use a completely different magnetic field. We use one that wraps around the detector in this way. So we have two different field configurations. We have one that wraps around going along the detector, and another one that wraps around kind of in circles around the detector in the other direction. And what that gives us is two different views of the momentum of particles going through. If we get our head-on view in the inner part of our detector, this is the same picture I showed you earlier, where you get particles bending as you're looking at it head-on. But when things get out to the outer part of our detector, muons are the only thing that make it out that far. Now you're looking at it from the side of the detector. You're not looking at it head-on here. And you see you get bending in a different direction. You get bending in the forward and backward direction. And so for us, that just gives us another measurement of the momentum in a different direction from the information that we already got inside the detector. Again, it's hard to say that one of these is fundamentally better than the other one. It's more like when these collaborations started, you had people who wanted to build things one way, and you had people who wanted to build things another way, and so we built two detectors. It's actually really useful scientifically to have two detectors that are made out of different materials that have different principles for detecting particles going through them. Because if one collaboration sees something that they think is new physics, new phenomena, a new particle or a new force or something, if the other experiment checks and they see the same thing with completely different technology, that gives you confidence that you're actually looking at something being caused by nature and not something being caused by the way you built your detector. I can't say that one of our collaborations is better than the other one. It's just that we're different and they kind of complement each other through those differences. All right, so we've talked about how the detectors work. We've got a basic idea of how we detect different types of particles going through. So now we're going to get to the meat of the talk. What have we seen in the 7 months of running at the LHC? And hopefully I'm not going to ruin this for you. We haven't seen any new physics. You probably would have heard about it in the New York Times or science journals. When we do find something, people are going to know about it. There's going to be a lot of press. So hopefully I haven't ruined the ending for you. We have seen something unexpected. I'll come to that at the end. If you read the handout, you might have some idea of what that's about. But first I'll tell you about some of the first measurements that we did. These were measurements about objects that we call jets. All right, so what's a jet in this case? Not an airliner, but it has to do with particles that interact through the strong force. So you might remember this picture from a few weeks ago. This was two quarks that are bound together through the strong nuclear force. And the key here, the thing that distinguishes the strong nuclear force from the other types of forces, is that as you pull these things apart, the force doesn't drop off like, if you pull two magnets apart, it gets easier as they get farther apart. That's not the case with the strong nuclear force. It's almost like you have a spring in between them, and so that force pulling them together gets even stronger as they get farther apart until it snaps. And what happens when it snaps? You've put in enough energy to create a particle and an antiparticle pair, so instead of just one hadron here, one thing that experiences the strong nuclear force, now you've got two hadrons. And you can imagine, that's just if you do it between two of them. If you have a whole bunch of them being, pulled apart or sent off in some direction, you're going to get a whole mess of particles all going in a similar direction. So when each of these colored groups of particles here represents is we think that there was a quark or a gluon carrier of the strong nuclear force, an individual one of those here at the center, and then it was ejected out in this direction. And as it's getting ejected out, it's being pulled pulled away from the other things that it's attracted to, and creating this spray of hadrons of strongly interacting particles going in, say, this direction. And maybe there was another quark that went off in this direction, so you get three or four particles coming out here. For the one that's labeled in green, there was a quark going in this direction, gets pulled apart, and you just get this spray of particles coming out. Quick question?
Are there images of what you use to understand the output, or is there a digital outputs? Or?
Yeah, so most of the information that we use to do our work is not represented graphically. Most of it is just computer algorithms running. What the graphics are useful for is looking at a few individual events and making sure that, kind of debugging, making sure we've done things right. And they're also useful for explaining this kind of stuff, what sort of processes are going on. I'll take one more question and please save your questions for the end, but yeah.
Can you explain again how the spray is generated? I know you said if you pull a quark away from another quark, uh-huh. somehow that produces a spray.
Yeah, this picture here is just, one at a time, but if let's say this initial up quark here was sent out with a lot of momentum in this direction off to your left here. And let's say this quark was created with a bunch of momentum going to the right. So they might get pulled apart here and have lost some of their energy going to create this particle antiparticle pair in the middle here. But they still might have some momentum left over. This thing's still trying to go. And so you do this a few more times, you get these sprays of particles coming out. So that's what's represented here. So this spray of particles, this is what we call a jet in our experiments. One of the first things you look for when you turn on an experiment like this is you look for events with jets in them. Why do you do that? Because jets come from these strongly interacting particles, these particles that experience a strong nuclear force. And what are you putting into the system? Well, you're putting in two protons which experience a strong nuclear force. So you have mainly strong nuclear force in. Most of the time you're going to get stuff coming out that also experiences a strong nuclear force. By and large, that's most of what you're going to get out of here. The other stuff that we're interested in, like things that experience the weak force or the electromagnetic force, are going to be at a much lower rate. It's going to be harder to see them. So that's why this is the first thing we look at, things with strongly interacting particles. So what can we look for? We can test the idea of whether quarks, which we think are fundamental, we can try to test whether they really are fundamental. And to show you how that works, I'm going to use an analogy with the hydrogen atom and what happens when you excite a hydrogen atom. Basically, so a hydrogen atom, remember, is just one proton, one electron orbiting it. And if this thing absorbs a photon, a bit of light, that can give this electron enough energy to go out into the next energy level up. So that's what's represented here. You've got your original energy level, and then the electron is, for a short time at least, orbiting at a higher energy level. And eventually it falls back down. This is an unstable situation here in the middle. So it falls back down and it kicks out a photon. So that's what exciting hydrogen looks like. And the reason you can do that is because hydrogen has two pieces to it. It's got a proton and an electron. Now, with quarks, if quarks had multiple parts to them, you could excite them in a similar way, except instead of using the photon, the electromagnetic force, you would use the strong nuclear force. And so here's two protons colliding together at the LHC, and let's say, hypothetically, they produce an excited quark. We just call that Q star. Star tends to mean excited in particle physics. So you have your excited quark here, and then it decays into a regular quark. That's like the excited hydrogen going back to regular hydrogen. And instead of kicking out photons, it kicks out a gluon. This is the thing that carries the strong nuclear force. So what would we see in our detector? What would this look like? Well, the quark here would actually be represented as a jet. It would look like a jet in our detector. The same thing for this gluon. This would look like another jet. And so we get something that looks like this, for example. We get something that looks like an event with a bunch of stuff coming out, and we have these two jets that have been outlined in red, these two cone-shaped objects coming out. So we do have events like this. We have a lot of them. And so how do we decide whether or not these are events that where you had something new, like an excited quark, which would tell us that quarks actually have pieces? That would be huge. If we found that. So how do you distinguish that situation from a situation where you just have two quarks created here and they just kind of go out and create two jets? It's going to look the same. What we do is we say, all right, let's assume for the sake of argument that these things did come from the same object, and we can figure out what would the mass of that object have been. And we do that based on how much energy is in these jets and what angles the jets are being scattered at. You can do a calculation to say what the mass would have been if there was a single particle that created those. And so we look at a lot of events like this, and we get the mass for each one. And we put that on a graph. And what you're seeing here is data from ATLAS and CMS. And these black points here are how often we found a certain mass of some hypothetical particle that would be an excited quark. CMS has the same thing. You see these black data points here. And what you'll notice is that they're falling kind of along this smooth shape. Now, what would we see if there was a real excited quark there, if there was something at a very specific mass that was producing these things? You would see a peak, and that's what's kind of outlined here in purple, blue, red, and they have other peaks here that CMS considered. That would be your signal for something new. And in this case, you see the data really don't have any peaking structure at all to them that we can see. It's just falling in this at this smooth rate, and it's consistent with what calculations give us, what simulations give us about just protons going in and quarks and gluons coming out, not from any specific particle, but just being kind of scattered off of each other. You get this kind of falling smooth shape. And so both of the experiments have been able to say, if excited quarks exist, based on this information here, sorry, my laser pointer's dying, if excited quarks exist, their mass must be greater than 1.5 tera electron volts, 1.5 trillion electron volts. This is actually about twice the limit that Fermilab has been able to set. And the reason LHC has been able to set such a, has been able to extend that by a factor of 2 in such a short time is mainly because we're at this higher energy. Where the energy is so much higher here, we need very little data to do a measurement like this and to set a limit. So we haven't, you can't completely rule something out, but you can say if it exists, it's got to be beyond where I've been able to measure. And so as we accumulate more data, we'll either find something or we'll just keep extending this limit to higher and higher masses. So that was one of the first results that came out of the experiments, one of the first places where we've been able to cut into theoretical models and say, well, okay, you guys predicted, excited quarks at 1 TeV. We've looked, it's not there, so your model's wrong, or you need to go back to the drawing board or something. So that was one of the first things we were able to do. The next thing that the experiments have done, so this is an example where we didn't see something, and hopefully you have at least some idea of, it's not completely worthless, we've been able to use that information. The next few examples are things that we have seen. So for example, one thing we've seen is one of the weak force carriers, the W boson. And in this case, I'm showing you an example of W decaying to an electron or a positron and a neutrino. So what does that look like in the detector? You see this really large red spike here. This is from the CMS experiment, and that shows a lot of energy being deposited in their electromagnetic calorimeter. So they say, this thing looks like an electron or a photon. The reason they're able to say it's an electron is because you look and there's a track pointing right at it. There's a charge track. This is from their innermost detector that detects charged particles. So if this thing were a photon, you wouldn't see this track here. You would just see energy and nothing on the inside. So this is definitely an electron. And I told you earlier, we don't detect neutrinos, but we can still infer their presence. And the way we do that is you add up the energy of everything else you see in this event, and you say, there's an imbalance. My energy is not balanced, on say this side compared to this side, and this arrow here shows the direction of that imbalance. And you say somehow there's energy escaping my detector, energy that I didn't see. That's probably a neutrino. It can be other things like miscalibration and things like that. So one. One event like this is not going to convince you that you've seen a W. You need a bunch of them. And I'll just mention here, there's other things that the W can decay to, like muons. That would also be easy to see. These other ones are not so easy, so that's why we haven't looked at them so much in the early data. So this is just one event here. What you get when you see a lot of events like this, you get something like this. So on the left here, this is my experiment. This is what we've seen that convinces us that we've seen W decays. You see, what we're plotting here is actually the energy of the electron in that calorimeter. And you can see you've got your data points, and what they're lying along here is this shape predicted by our simulation using the Monte Carlo methods that I talked about last week. You can see actually the data that we're seeing match our simulation almost perfectly. So that tells us two things. One, it tells us that we're pretty sure we're seeing real W events. It also tells us that our simulation is actually pretty good since these things are lying right on top of each other. There's these other colors here, different types of backgrounds. And you can see the background levels are very low. What CMS has done to see the W to electron neutrino process is instead of looking at the energy of the electron, they've reconstructed the mass of that W. And so you can see that peak is right here around 80 billion electron volts. With Atlas, our peak was just under 40, and that's because the electron carries about half of the energy. So for CMS, what they've done is, you know, they've looked at the mass of that W, and again, their data points here lie right on top of the simulation of this W process, and then they have other backgrounds here that are seen at lower masses. So this is one of the ways in which we've been able to say, all right, we see the W process. The other thing we've been able to see is here, Z. This is the other type of weak force carrier, the Z boson. And the example I'm showing here is Z decaying to two muons, a positively charged and a negatively charged one. And those are represented by these red lines here. You can see these are the only particles in this event that make it out to our muon system. Everything else has been absorbed here in the middle. So that's how, you know, that's how we can tell when we see something out here, it's almost certainly a muon. And there's other decay modes that it can have, but right here I'm showing Z to muons. And again, we look at lots of events like this and put it on a graph. Here what we're doing is we're plotting the mass of the Z boson that we're detecting based on the two muons that are coming out. And so again, you see my experiments on the left here and CMS on the right. And probably the first thing you're noticing is, hey, these data points are not matching up with this simulated curve here for my experiment. Whereas for the other experiment, they are kind of lying on top of each other. What this means for us is that it doesn't mean that the data is wrong. It means our simulation is a little bit wrong. So we looked at this, and what's happened is this bit here with the data not being as sharply peaked as our simulation means that we got our resolution wrong. We thought we were more precise than we actually are. So what that's done is it's spread out our distribution. It's kind of washed it out a little bit, so we don't get something peaking as sharply. So we actually had to go back and tune our simulation and say, hey, look, you know, we thought we were this precise on certain measurements. Turns out we weren't. So we feed that back into our simulation, and in the future, our simulations are going to be more accurate. Now, for the purposes of this detection of seeing the Z, we definitely saw it. I mean, we still see a peak here at exactly the right mass. So there's no question about whether we saw it. It's just we didn't see it as precisely as we thought we did. So that's a learning experience. That's one of the, although W's and Z's have been seen in the lab before, this is why it's useful for us to try and see them in our own equipment to see if we've got everything calibrated right. And in this case, we needed to do a little more calibration. So that was valuable. The last particle I'm going to talk about is top quarks. These are the heaviest quarks, heaviest particles that we know about. And how are they produced? Well, again, you have a proton and another proton hitting each other. That produces, most of the time, it produces a top and an anti-top. And these things, tops almost always decay to a W boson. It's one we just talked about a few slides ago, and a B quark. And this thing, what this thing will do is it'll create a jet. And this other anti-B quark is going to create another jet, so you know you have at least two jets in your event. And I have the other W decay modes here, but you don't see them. So at least I highlighted the ones that we're concerned about. These are the easiest ones to see, where the W decays to an electron or a muon and a neutrino. And so we're going to look for that on both sides. Now, the good thing about looking for it in this way is that electrons and muons are real easy to see. So if we see, you know, two electrons or two muons, or an electron and a muon, and two jets, that's something that looks like a top quark. But it only happens about 5% of the time. So you're cutting out a lot of your possible signal. So we've traded a very clear signature for statistics. We're going to have lower statistics because we're only going to pick up 5% of these processes. But this is what it would look like. So you see here in the center, we've got these two purple cones. You can see it in the head-on view here. These are our jets representing B quarks. And then in this case, we saw a muon in red. That's the only thing that makes it out to this muon system. And the other thing we saw was an electron. So you see a track here in the middle. This is it on the head-on view. And a signal at our electromagnetic calorimeter. So this is what we call a top quark candidate event. It's something that looks like a top. And again, you don't declare that you've seen something unless you've seen it a bunch of times. Now, for my experiment, we haven't gone public with how many of these we've seen, so we have not claimed an official observation yet. The other experiment CMS has, and they've seen when they look at events like this that have two of these jets some combination of electrons and muons, two of them, CMS looks at those events and they say, all right, if we ignored top quarks, then our simulations say we should get 1 to 3 events. And the reason there's some uncertainty is because there are just certain things about your detector that you don't know. You have to put in some probabilities and do your Monte Carlo simulation to come out with, you know, what's the range of things you would expect to see. So for non-top events, they expect to see 1 to 3 events. And what they actually see is 11. And what this graph is showing you here is the number of jets they've seen that are consistent with B quarks. And so you can see in the case where they've seen one B quark and just another jet that is probably a B but hasn't been identified as such, you see a lot of this red signal here. This red color here is from simulation, and the black points are what they actually found in the data. And so everything is pretty consistent within the error bars. And even though they've only seen a few of these, it's certainly enough in excess over what they would have seen without top that they can claim that they've actually seen it. So that's of course my experiment. We're working on it. We should have something very soon. Part of the reason we're taking a little bit longer is because we're not just looking at this case where you get, you know, a muon and an electron. We're also looking at cases where you get more jets. So it's harder to do. It's taking us a little bit longer, but hopefully we'll have a more precise measurement. So that's how we've used things that have been seen already, particles that we already knew about, to tell us something about how well our detectors are working. Now, we come to something unexpected. There's one unexpected thing that we've seen at the LHC. It's not a smoking gun for new phenomenon, and I'll tell you why. So first of all, what have we actually seen? The CMS experiment has looked at proton collisions that produce a large number of these charged tracks coming out of the center here. Most of the time, most of the event displays I've shown you are fairly simple. They don't have quite this many particles coming out. So CMS has looked at cases where you get a lot of them coming out, and they want to look at correlations between the directions these particles are traveling. Let's see if I can make that a little bit simpler here. Let's take a simple event that doesn't have hundreds of tracks going through it, but we can talk about correlations at least. So this is kind of events that we've seen a lot, you know, a jet going one way, a jet going the other direction. And we can say, all right, let's take two particles in here, say particle A and particle B, and we want to look at, if I take a particle A, how likely is it that there's going to be another particle near it traveling in the same direction? And so if you pick two particles within the same jet, you're going to get a higher probability that they're going in the same direction. So it could be either this jet or the other jet. We're not concerned about which direction it is, just whether they're going in the same direction. If you pick one particle from one jet and one particle from another jet, then you're going to find that they're anti-correlated. There's one going, you see one going in one direction, one going the other direction. So to make this a little more quantitative, we can define the angles that we're concerned about. So here I'm approximating our detector with a cylinder. This is what our detector looks like, basically. And there's two angles that we're concerned with. And for some reason, physicists like to use Greek letters, so we got Greek letters here. We're concerned with difference in the phi direction. That's the angles that you get when you're looking head-on at the detector. And then there's the other direction, the other angle that we call eta. That's the direction, that's the angle that you get when you're looking along the side of the detector. So just keep in mind, these are the two angles that we're going to be concerned with. And So what's the correlation going to look like for an event like this? Well, it's what you've got here in this plot. Now it's a little complicated, but I'll try to break it down. You have the phi direction along this axis, and so that's like unrolling our cylinder here. Kind of unroll it and plotted it in one direction. So that's the phi direction. Then you've got the eta direction. This is along the cylinder. What you've got on the vertical axis is some measure of how correlated things are. So what's this big peak here at delta phi of 0 and delta eta of 0? It's something where it's a big peak where you have two particles that are going roughly in the same direction measured with this angle, and also roughly the same direction measured with this angle. And that's consistent with with jet production, with having two jets in the event. And so this is by far one of the most common types of events that we get in our detectors. So that's what's responsible for this big peak here. What about this other peak here? Well, this in the phi direction, this is happening at about 180 degrees away. This axis isn't given in degrees, so I'm translating, but it's 180 degrees away in phi, and so what we're seeing here is the phi direction in this head-on view. And so that means you've taken a particle from one jet and a particle from the other jet, and that's why you're getting this peak here. And why is it spread out in the eta direction? Because there's not much correlation in this direction in the side-to-side view in terms of which direction these jets are pointed. But in the head-on view, there is a strong correlation, so that's why you see the strong peak that's small in both directions. All right, so hopefully that was somewhat clear. I mean, basically, this peak gives you particles that are correlated from within one jet. This other peak comes from choosing two particles in different jets. That's the bottom line. So CMS has looked at this now in events with lots and lots of tracks, and they've actually seen something pretty similar. You have, again, a strong peak at phi and eta of 0, and then another spread out peak in the other direction. So this is what they get when they look at events with more than 110 charged particles where they're looking in the low energy range. Now, something a little bit unexpected happens when they go to the higher energy range. And you may not have seen it unless you read the handout here, so I'm going to flip back and forth here. The only thing that's really changing between these two graphs is this one here with this moderate energy particles has a very slight ridge here along phi of 0, and it extends throughout eta. This was the unexpected thing. I know it doesn't seem like much, but all of the other graphs that we've seen like this with these two jet events don't have this extra ridge here. And so this is puzzling. Is this something new, or is this a problem with our understanding of how the strong force works at high energies and with lots of particles? Which way does it go? The answer is, at the moment, we don't know. We don't know if this is something new or if it's just a problem with our understanding of the strong force. Why is that? Well, the strong force is mathematically very difficult. There are approximations that we can use to make calculations concerning the other forces, the electromagnetic force, the weak force, those approximations are not valid for the strong force, and so it's just very hard to do calculations, and so people are working on this to see if this is something that you can expect, or is it really something new going on. Regardless of if it's expected or new, we can at least get a physical picture of what's happening. So what would have to happen to make that kind of ridge structure? You would need something like kind of a line, some object here that's emitting particles. So this line is actually traveling outward from the center, first of all. And so it's emitting particles that are all kind of next to each other in the phi direction. So that's this delta phi 0. But emitting particles that are going in all sorts of different directions in eta along the detector. So it would have to be some jumbled mishmash like this in one direction, ordered in the other direction. So that's just putting these two next to each other. So the question is, what could give you a structure like this? One possibility, and there's by no means any consensus on this, but it's one possibility that, at least for me, is easy to imagine, is somewhat easy to imagine, is you have these two protons coming towards each other. They're coming towards each other along, well, I really lost my laser pointer, along the direction of this cylinder here. You know, there's protons coming from the left and protons coming from the right. And as they get close to each other, you can imagine that almost like a line of force forms between them when they get close enough. And this force is the strong nuclear force. And it's, in some way, it's kind of like the electromagnetic force. You know, you can imagine magnetic or electric field lines going between these two things in almost like a tube shape. And that would be something like this, some extended tube shape that would give you this. But of course, it's not the electromagnetic force. It's much stronger. So this strong force here, as this thing is being ejected out from the center and kind of disintegrating, this they call it a flux tube. This tube of strong force is emitting particles in close together in phi because it's being ejected outward from the center, but then in any direction along the detector. So that's one possible explanation. The jury's still out. So this is interesting. We need to keep an eye on this. The other thing to mention is that it's actually similar to features that were seen, ridge like this, was also seen at experiments that collide atomic nuclei, like lead and gold. That happens at Brookhaven National Lab on Long Island, for example. So what's going on with the LHC now? We stopped taking data with protons on November 4th. We switched over, actually, to colliding lead ions, lead nuclei. So that actually may shed some light on this unusual ridge structure. It might give us a little bit more information. What's really going to give us more information is just getting more data, so that instead of looking at the correlation between just two particles, we can look at correlations between three, four, five, or more particles. And more data is what's going to help there. So the plan is to run with colliding lead nuclei for another few weeks till about the beginning of December, and then CERN shuts off for the winter because electricity prices go up and people use a lot of electric to heat their homes over in Europe. So they shut off for the winter. We're going to turn on again next spring, colliding protons again, and the goal for next year is to have our detectors exposed to 100 trillion proton collisions. So far, we've done about 3 trillion, so we're about 3% there. So next year, we're really going to go for it and really hope that our data-taking efficiency is really high and that we get as much data as possible. And they've kind of hinted, the accelerator people have hinted that we might get quite a bit more data than we expect, maybe a factor of 2 or 3 more than we expect, so that would be really nice. They might also bump up the energy. Instead of running at 7 trillion electron volts, we might run at 8 or 9, depending on how comfortable the accelerator operators are with going up to those higher energies. So next year could be really interesting because that even at slightly higher energy, 20 or so percent more, 15-20%, might give you more sensitivity to detecting the Higgs boson, or just in general, better sensitivity to heavier new particles that might be waiting for us to discover them. So I'm optimistic about next year. I can't say what our chances are. I have no idea what we're going to find, but I think it's going to put us into some really interesting territory for either ruling out some of the more common theoretical ideas that have been around for the last 30 years, or what would be really exciting would be maybe finding something. So we'll see. Thanks. Before I take questions, I just want to remind you that we're going to take a couple of weeks off. There's no lecture again until December 11th. That'll be our final one. But on December 4th, they're doing a physics open house here at the university called Physics with a Bang. So there's some information on that near the handouts. Questions about LHC? Yeah?
Is the W force a attractive or repulsive force?
That's a good question. It's both in that it's similar in some ways. It's similar to the electromagnetic force. So with the W force, you do have things that are like positive charges and things that are like negative charges. And so, you know, in those cases, you still get the opposites attract and likes repel situation. So it does go both ways. It's just very, very short range. I mean, even smaller than, you know, it has a range of maybe the width of a proton. It's very small. Yeah? Yeah.
Each of them points to silly gray that would have been, I guess, the computer model of the curve. Mm-hmm. Are those individual points, or they represent many hits at one point, and then you do a quadratic fit, or any other?
Yeah, so let me see if I can actually, no, it's going to take me longer to get to that than just to give you the answer. So, but if you remember back to this picture of tracking these charged particles through our detector, this is the picture with these multicolored curved lines coming out. The question was, with the individual hits, those little squares there, are they individual points or are they like clusters? The answer is it's actually both. So when there's a bunch of them close together, our software actually tries to cluster them and take an average. Because it says, you know, maybe this particle just deposited more energy, you know, a little more energy than average, and so it's kind of spread out a little bit. Sometimes we just see an individual hit. And so what the software then tries to do is take all of those together and see whether it can fit a curve to those hits. And then there's some quality on how good that fit can be and, you know, how far the hits are away from the curve. So anyway, short answer is it's both.
How big is the team
in which you work? These teams are huge. Yeah, this is one thing I maybe mentioned a couple of times over the last few weeks, but it's each collaboration, CMS and Atlas, has about 3,000 people working on it. These are huge collaborations. I mean, together, I think if you take all of the physicists working on the Large Hadron Collider, I think it's something like 20% of all high-energy physicists throughout the world are working on this thing. So it's really, I'm not sure about that number, so don't quote me, but it's some large number. I heard it somewhere, so I could be wrong. But anyway, these are huge collaborations. I suppose, you know, maybe where you're going with this is how do we get any work done? We work in small teams, is how it works. So for example, here at the University of Chicago, there's about six of us working together on a few different measurements. And it's similar at other university groups, or sometimes you get collaborations between different groups, but they all tend to be, I mean, the groups that actually get real work done tend to be pretty small. Because as you get bigger, you have to have more and more bureaucracy to manage people. So, question in the back.
Yeah, I was just wondering, the muon detector?
Yeah.
Is there anything in there that would stop the tauons from getting there, or are you just ignoring those because there aren't so many of them?
So I haven't talked about taus very much. Now, taus are like muons and electrons, except they're yet heavier. A tau weighs about almost as much as two protons, not quite, but it's a very heavy particle. But other than that, it's very similar to the electron. The difference between muons and electrons and taus is that taus decay very rapidly. They decay almost without traveling any distance at all. So it's really right at the center of the detector. So the only way we detect taus is by looking at their decay product. And so those the important detectors for that are the inner tracking chamber, if they decay to charged particles, and they also decay to some neutral hadrons. And so the hadronic calorimeter is also very useful for that. Yeah.
Do you have a pretty, I think you indicated that for that spray or that event with like 120 or more particles, but you weren't quite sure what everything was. But for lower levels or numbers of particles, do you have a pretty deterministic explanation for what you're seeing?
I guess with a lower number of particles, or when you have, you know, very few jets in the event, I think the calculations are easier in terms of using the strong force to predict what you're going to get. There's the way we do all of these calculations are with varying levels of approximation. So, you know, I think once you get out to like hundreds of charged particles, then some of your approximations break down. So. So I think, yeah, in the simpler events, I think they are better understood in terms of what's coming out.
But maybe you're not interested in a strictly step-by-step process that explains what you're seeing, but you're more interested in certain energy levels for events.
Yeah, in this case, it was a matter of going between a low number of particles and a high number, and somewhere in the middle is where the mathematics starts to get kind of rough and less precise. So, I mean, so that's another thing that more data is going to be used for, is we can, we have some data here on the high end and on the low end, and we do have stuff in the middle too, but as you gather more data, you can just refine the whole process and really get break up the data into smaller and smaller chunks. Right now we kind of have to take fairly large chunks of data at a time just to get enough statistics to tell us anything at all. All right, so I've got two more questions, I think, as we're going over time here, but yeah.
Yeah, why is the LHC shutting down for the whole winter?
There's a few reasons. One of them, they do shut down every winter because that's when electricity in Europe costs the most. So there's a very practical reason. But what we're also doing in this shutdown is we're going to open up both detectors because both teams have improvements that they want to make. So for example, with my detector, we've had some power supplies fail in the middle of it. I mean, these are just kind of expected standard electronic failures. Not many, but enough that we want to go in and make some replacements. So I mean, there's maintenance to be done during these shutdown times.
But you figure every winter you're going to shut down just because
of
the cost of the electricity?
Yeah, that's last winter there was some talk maybe of not shutting down, but because that was right when we were starting up and things were really exciting. They still shut down anyway because they ran into problems with the unions working at the lab. They had it in their contract that they had to have Christmas off and New Year. So it's I think for practical reasons.
Does this affect other colliders like Fermi?
And Fermi Lab actually tends to have their shutdown during the summer because here in the U.S. we like air conditioners and that's when our electricity costs go up. Based on my limited experience, in the U.S. the accelerators shut down in the summer, and in Europe they shut down in the winter. Because electricity, it does cost a lot. We do use a lot of electricity. So, all right, you had a question, right?
Yes. These collisions occur inside the tube, inside the racetrack.
Uh-huh.
What's the cross section at the point where the collisions occur, and what's the tube's wall made of?
So, I'll answer the easier question first. The wall of our tube where we're accelerating the protons is made out of beryllium. The reason is beryllium is a very light material, it's not likely to absorb or scatter anything coming out of the collision, so we can get better precision on it. The harder question, what's the cross section? It's very small. let me see if I can carry all these factors with 10 in my head. I'll have to do this out loud. So it's about 70 millibars. Okay, what does that mean? Barn is a unit that's used a lot in nuclear. In the nuclear physics field. So a barn is 10 to the minus 24 square centimeters, and so we're doing 70 thousandths of that, so 10 to the minus 27, 26, about 10 to the minus 25 square centimeters, roughly. I mean, it's very tiny. That's a pretty good approximation. It's not quite on, but it's pretty close. I mean, it's very tiny. I mean, you have to think it's roughly on the sizes here, roughly the widths of the protons, extremely tiny. All right, so I'm gonna stop questions here. Thanks again for coming, and I'll stick around up front for more questions.